here, and then Mike told you that I was the seventh grade teacher principal. It was shortly after I got there. I'm not sure how many years I was there before Mike was in my class. He might have been right at the start.
I think you're about 5 years in.
Yeah, I think it took him 3 years to get through seventh grade. Created the finalists that we have today. So that was right out of college. I came there. Stormy ministry, in that they had a year vacancy in the principalship there. They had been calling from the field for quite a long period of time. And then that call came up to the Conference of Presidents in the spring of the year that I graduated, and they said, who do we like the least that we can see? And so then I ended up in, and it was call night, and I'm looking down at my future wife, my family's in between us, and I'm looking down at her, and I'm going, God has a sense of humor. So, and I've been here ever since, 20-some years at the high school. I have acquired AP psychology as my discipline to teach there. I inherited it. It was a startup course that somebody else was going to teach. They left, and it was the summer of that year, the same year that I inherited becoming director of guidance and counseling, and then I inherited AP psychology. So I have my master's degree in educational psychology with an emphasis in school counseling, and that's what led me to the high school. And then I've been teaching this course, AP psychology, for, it's got to be going on 15 years or so now. Love it. I get down to AP reading, where we correct the national exams that are given every year. I get invited to do that, and the College Board pays me. They fly me down there, they feed me, and they say, sit in this locked room for 8 hours and read essays until we're all done. So we do that. It doesn't sound like fun, but that's helped my teaching greatly. I've met lots of cool people down there doing that. But in the process of all of that, I get to tell people I truly get to practice what I teach. And so every day I'm teaching psychology to students, and then I bring it alive for them in how it applies into their everyday life. So Mike wasn't entirely honest with you about this topic and me being expert in it. My children, I have four children, I now am a grandfather of eight, and that has been just a ball. It's just a riot. So those of you that are raising your children right now, there's hope. I just want you to know, okay? There's hope. The grandchildren, being a grandfather is just an awesome, awesome experience. So it's been just a blessing. Grandmothers are even more privileged, I found out recently, than the grandfathers. So, but I actually did this topic, and I was trying to recall, I did this topic years and years ago. It was shortly after I got to the high school. I remember being at North Trinity at the time, Loving Shepherd, and the Metro Milwaukee Conference invited me to come and talk and speak on this topic of bullying. I don't think cyberbullying existed back then. I remember going into, and I gave my talk in the church, and I had an overhead projector, and I had what was my PowerPoint on those clear acetates, and I'd take one off and I'd put the next one on, and I'd be talking about all of that and what was going on and happening here. So when Mike, some time ago, we reached out to each other through a connection, and he asked me if I would be willing to come here and do it, I didn't hesitate, because one of the things that it forced me to do now was to get back into this, and to go back and research and update and what I believe I already knew about it, but then what's new and what's changed. I have more than an hour-long presentation. so please do not make me the sage on the stage. Engage me, stop me, ask me questions, keep me moving on the stuff that you don't want me to go over, and then we'll get through the stuff that you want to cover and that you're interested in. You're living it, and with your children. I have grandchildren coming up. They're never ever going to have social media where they live. They're out in the boonies in Warrens, Wisconsin, in Cranberry Country, and there's no electricity there. So, Grandpa has to go out at night and pedal the bicycle to keep the lights going. So, I'm sure it's going to happen at some point in time. But, So it's scary stuff. And you're going to be part of Choice, right? Or you are?
We are.
The Choice program. With that comes some state mandates, just so you know. One of the things that I want to tell you up front and encourage you as an organization now and as a group of people that have now come together is the law actually went into play in 2010, March of 2010, and Wisconsin schools were mandated by the state to develop what are called bullying policies. The state does not have a definition by law for bullying and what it is. It has a definition by law for what harassment is. It talks about what you can and cannot do on a telephone. But it does not have a specific definition for what bullying is. But yet the state mandated you as a school must have a policy that governs and handles bullying. So that was interesting for me to find out. Now, I was told that we have a bullying policy at Wisconsin Lutheran High School. I have yet to see it in print. Okay, I'm just being a little bit transparent with you. That doesn't mean that it doesn't exist. At the time that we were developing and putting together, I did offer and reach out to help, but I was not involved in that process. So this piqued some interest in me because now I'm going to go back and I've got to follow up and make sure we're addressing it because it does come up in our office from time to time in many different ways. So I have a little bit of a, I have to be honest with you, I have a psychological bent to all of this as to how does this come about and how does this happen. So as I was exploring this and looking into all of this, I mean, what are kids thinking? And I have to be honest with you because there's a part of me that wants to tell you they aren't. Okay? And one of the reasons I'm saying they aren't is because they can't. And it's a brain development thing that through my psychology and over the years and neuroscience now, what neuroscience has shown us is to say to a student, and I heard Mike say it in his devotion, Think about the consequences. Think before you talk. They might not be able to do it. And I'm just being honest with you. So they've got this device in their hand and they're shooting stuff out there and it might be hurtful words or something and that part of the brain's not engaged that there are consequences to this. And so that's your role as parents, and that's what God, that's why God gifted you with those wonderful little human beings that you have to raise, because you're going to help them to understand, you're going to help them to think through the processes, you're going to make them aware. One of the privileges that I have is creating awareness through education in young people, and I still believe that that is the key to lighting the fire in their hearts, not only with what they're going to do personally in their lives, but how they're going to change and how they're going to change things. So it's been a privilege to do that. It's a privilege to be here with you tonight, but please don't think I'm a sage on the stage. I don't claim to be. I put together a lot of information. I made this PowerPoint available to Mike. I said he can share it with you. I have my resources on here. They're linked. They're great resources. They've been very, very helpful to me. So I'll talk with you about it in a little bit. So I believe that all of this stuff that's going on and happening with children today comes out of a need to belong. human beings have a need to be together, to belong to someone else, to belong to a group, and to be together. God said it way back in Genesis. And he looked down and saw Adam, and he said, "It is not good for man to be alone. And I will make a helper suitable for him." And then he brought Adam and Eve together, and he said, "Be fruitful and multiply, and I have given you this creation to take charge of and to be good stewards of, and have families and raise children and spread out." The Greek philosopher Aristotle said, "Man's a social animal," and children demonstrate that every day. Not only the schools that they're at, the organizations they belong to, the clubs they belong to, they have this need to fit in, and they want to know that they're accepted. Erickson's got stages of social development, 8 stages of social development. 2 of those stages deal with adolescents and young adults, and it's all about relationships that they form and that they can have. And what they look for in different periods of their life. And so I think that need to belong is a basic human motivation that each of us has. Think about the groups, think about the organizations, your workplaces, here at church, in school, out in the community, how you're connected and how you're networked, with your families, how you reach out to other people, and we see that need to belong. Denise and I, my wife and I, would love to get away. We were over Christmas break. We went up to her parents' cabin. They go down to Florida, and then we go clean. And I got to be careful what I say because I'm on tape now, so this can't. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Some things can't get back to Mrs. Schumacher. So. But anyway, we went off the grid. There's no internet up there. There's no TV up there because they shut it off. And we tell them, don't turn it back on, even though we might be coming up there. And we shared that information with somebody in a workplace one day while we were up there. And her jaw, she's a young mom, her jaw, she said, "How do you survive?" And you know, we just smiled because we're dealing with technology every day in our workplace, and it can be a great source of frustration for us. So at times we love to get away from it. But your kids, your children are all give it to me, give me more, give me the latest, and give me the best. And what do you mean you can't afford it? Right? And so give me more, and they're good with it. So. Simple definition for you, right here with bullying, it's any kind of aggressive behavior that demonstrates an imbalance of power and then it's repeated. Okay? Unless you have questions, I'm just going to keep moving through this. Okay? So I'm going to caution you in a little bit about what goes on and happens in different places where is it bullying or is it something else that's going on and happening? And that's where we have to, as parents, be careful. We, as educators, be careful. We don't overreact. And we'll talk about that. I even have a little activity for you if we have time. So you're going to keep the clock, too, so don't let me go over. As far as cyberbullying is concerned, definition is the same. It's going to create an imbalance of power. We're going to see some repetition going on and happening, but here's where it gets dangerous, right? So it can go on around the clock. So usually a physical type of bullying is when we're together face to face. So then when our students worry, they're worried about going to school, or they're worried about going to this club or this organization or this activity because they're going to be picked on, or they're going to be bullied, or they're going to be harassed, however you want to describe it. But electronically, with social media, when does it stop? know, this is where the thought process in children sometimes isn't what yours is. You know about this stuff, and you know that you're going to leave an imprint, you're going to leave a footprint. Somehow, some way, somebody else has access to that. And so that's where you're going to guide your children and lead your children. What's acceptable, what's not acceptable. Create an awareness. So what are some types of bullying? I have to tell you this too. I move around a lot, okay? I'm deaf, okay? I flat out tell my students. So I've got my hearing aids turned up right now, but so in the classroom, it's very difficult for me to hear. I never used to have hearing aids. When they finally figured stuff out digitally, all of a sudden, the whole world changed for me. The first time I got hearing aids about 5 years ago, I cried almost all the way home. I could hear engine sounds that I had never heard in my car before, and stuff like that. So it's been a cool experience for me, but it doesn't take care of all the problems that I have. So I move around and I move towards people when they start talking, so don't be intimidated by that. My students are at first, and then they get used to it. My classroom's usually way louder than anybody else's classroom is too, because I just have a tolerance for principal comes walking in like, what's going on in here? And go, oh, they actually are learning. So, so what are some types of bullying that go on and happen in settings that your children find themselves in? What's going on? Somebody earlier, I heard him say something about a bubbler ride. We used to get bubbler rides. Oh. Yeah. Who was that?
Oh,
talking about.
Don't put me on the spot.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Okay. They never caught me.
Oh, you ran.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Right. Okay. So, okay. So, sort of
hate. Physical bullying. There's emotional. There would be the cyberbullying. There would be, I would say, maybe indirect type of bullying where you, it's almost like you're creating a problem for someone else to let their mind run and make it worse than it is, mm-hmm. just by kind of setting them up and then just not making sure they're okay type of thing. That would be the type of bullying I'm thinking.
You sound very experienced in this. Okay. So, yeah. So, you've got most of them. So, physical is a big one that we worry about and we're concerned about, but I mean, it can be the hurtful words that Mike introduced us with the short devotions. And some of those are thoughtless because of developmental age of the children. And I can talk about some brain biology here when I get to the end of all of this to help you kind of understand. Hopefully what you need to do a little bit more of with your children. I handle juniors and seniors at the high school a lot differently than I handle the freshmen and sophomores. And it's because I'm aware of just the developmental change in the brain between sophomore and junior year. All of a sudden they can see a light bulb go on as you're talking to the kids, and they finally stuff starts to resonate with them. And so the social bullying, you mentioned some of those things that can go on, reputations, relationships, and then the physical bullying. Okay, questions or comments about any of that so far? Okay, so what are the roles that the students play if we have a bullying situation going on? And I want you to think about there's more than two individuals there.
Well, the indirect, the standby guy that doesn't interrupt.
Okay. All right. Any others?
There's the person bullying and the one being bullied.
Yeah, there's the bully. There's a person being bullied. We've got the bystanders. Okay.
We also have people that encourage it too.
Okay. You've got the children there that might be egging it on. Okay. I've seen it happen in conflicts at school, not a bullying situation, but two individuals are having a disagreement during the course of the day, and as the day progresses, it escalates. How does it escalate?
Other people talk
Other
about
students
it.
Are feeding it. Mm-hmm. Okay, hey, maybe we can get to see a fight after school today. Kind of cool. Right? And then they, so, yeah. So we've got all of that. So directly involved in the situation that we have the bully. Okay, and I want you to stop and think for a minute, because we sometimes assume bad things about the bully, okay? And I think by the time I get through this tonight, I'm hoping you have a little bit of different perspective and look at how I described it there. And then we have the person that's being bullied. Okay? Both of those individuals need help. Okay? Both of those individuals need help going forward into the future. And one of my last slides tonight, they're more alike than they are different. Those two individuals are more alike than they are different. You're going to be surprised when we get, hopefully not surprised, maybe you know already, than you may think. So remember, we have, with our definition, we have an imbalance of power, and then we have repetitive type of behavior going on and happening. So on the outskirts of all this going on and happening, we have the bystander, okay? Who else is there? Okay, and someone said, who's encouraging it? Mm-hmm. And may occasionally join in.
Yeah, there's the lookout, too.
Pardon?
The lookout. The lookout person watching.
Yeah.
So no adult comes. And
yeah. Yeah, oh yeah, you can have those, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I'm not sure. You're talking about the young man
the
in front
front?
There?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he's holding his backpack and he's kind of like, boy, I'm not sure I want
to
get involved
this
in this. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is bad. Yeah. That's my take on it. But I didn't think about the lookout, but that's a very valid point, sure.
I teach in a public school.
Yeah, well, see? Yeah. They do that when they come to psychology class late some days, too. Here it comes. Okay, so the assistants, the encourage, the reinforcers, okay, maybe providing an audience, and knowingly or unknowingly, okay, they're fueling the fire. So you see how that's happening? Because they're part of the audience, I'm feeding the scenario that's going on and happening, and I may be feeding the bully and encouraging the bully, even though that's not my intent. And then we have the outsiders. Okay. And these are the children and the students we want to engage. These are the children we want to form the swarm. That are going to make the difference. If we can get these kids to talk up, to gain some confidence, and to know that there's a support system in place that they can go to where they're going to get the help that they need to help this other person, you're going to diminish the activity that's going on and happening in school. There's power in numbers, right? There's power in numbers. And so you change a mindset, and that mindset carries over into a group of people. You change an attitude, you change a culture, and then all of a sudden, it's gone. I was at the very least harassed my freshman year in high school. In a big way. I brought it all on myself. There was hazing going on in my high school, and I was second generation out of my family going to that high school. Both my mom and dad went there. my older brothers were at a public high school, and they said, you are gonna go to this high school, somebody in this family's going to college, no pressure there. And so then I got there my freshman year, didn't know anybody, no friends, nothing, and I'm walking down the hallway, and they had this freshman initiation stuff going on in Hazy. I was as arrogant and cocky and self-confident as I could have possibly been as a young freshman, and there was no way nobody was going to make me do any of that stuff. I don't care who you are, okay? They were merciless. That by the time I ended my semester, my freshman year, I wanted out of there. I just wanted to get out of there. Some events happened and changed all of that for the good, and it went away. But what good came out of that? I teamed up with some classmates after our freshman year, and we worked very, very hard. I had a younger sister that was going to be coming into that school, and I said, no, how, no way is she going to go through any of this stuff. So that by the time we were seniors and we graduated, because it was the seniors that were doing it, we said, this has got to stop. This has got to stop. And so we worked very, very hard to not use and usurp our power over the underclassmen, but to, at the very least, if they were that annoying, just to ignore them and let them live their lives as high school students. And it can happen. I didn't know that I was doing it that way intentionally, but now looking back on it after all these years, I can see that. And then you have the children that are going to stick up for it. Okay? Well, you know what happens to them, right?
They get bullied.
Okay, it's a vicious cycle. Vicious cycle. Right? Okay. One thing I would caution you on, though, is think about this, too. We talk about the bully, we talk about the victim, and then just be careful about the labels. From a psychological point of view, honestly, I talk with my students about this a lot, and you know, the label that gets attached, okay? The student that comes in that has a learning disability, and I've got to inform the teacher as the student's counselor and put an instructional learning plan in place. I'm very careful to define for the teachers what the learning problems are, what the difficulties are. And just, you know, well, he's autistic, or he's, you know, he's ADHD. Okay, and so all of a sudden you attach a label to it, and it has that negative connotation to it, and then all of a sudden we've got this going on and happening, and we've got self-fulfilling prophecies, either intentionally or unintentionally by the teachers and the students, and now that student's not going to be successful in that environment. Because I'm not going to spend as much time with it. You have a learning disability where she's gifted and talented, where am I going? Okay, it's much easier here than it is over here for the educator and the people working with those children. So sometimes these have unintended consequences, and we talked in your devotion tonight about thinking before you talk. How do you want to present this to the kids, your children, and you know, if you say, well, you're bullying, can you describe the behaviors? And you're doing this behavior, do you see why this is bad or why this would be a wrong thing to do? So it can send the message that the child's behavior cannot change. Bullied in one situation, but maybe the bully in another situation. And so then what's the roles change? And then do we disregard the factors that are contributing? As I was reading and preparing for tonight, one of the most recent things I read that just stuck with me was the word stress, and how stressed out students tend to lean toward aggression. If I'm, and I see it in myself, if I get stressed out, okay, and I'm stressed out over something, I'm a little more on edge, I'm a little more quick with my reaction, and the hurtful words or the thoughtless words all of a sudden are closer to the tip of my tongue than if I'm with less stress. I have time to be calm, cool, collected, think about things. And so you know how stress affects you, can affect you in a negative way. So you have your child that's under stress here at school. They're performing poorly academically, and that's stressing them out. What's going on at home that may be stressing them out? Family changes, health-related issues with a family member, loss of a grandparent, something like that, and then all of a sudden those factors now are feeding into, and are we going to give that student a fair chance to express all of that and get that out so that we can help them, so that we can direct them with appropriate behavior in situations and how to handle that stress. Who are the students at risk of being bullied? I think you know, right? Who are they?
Pretty much anybody at some point.
Okay. What might be happening to anybody at some point? How are they? How are the other people? How are their peers viewing them that they're being bullied? Can you describe some ways it might be different?
You can.
Okay. What else?
If you look different, maybe you have a disability where you walk with a limp or something, you act different, you physical attributes.
Great. Physically different. Okay.
If you're quiet or like spend the time alone.
Okay. Shy, introverted. All right. So somehow, some way, a lot of times these children are perceived as different, and it can be a physical appearance, it can be a disability. The weakness is there somehow, some way. These are contributing factors. These are not the only factors. So I'm careful to share some of this stuff with you that you don't overreact. That's not saying that all children that are being bullied are depressed. Okay, so don't read more into them because they may be, okay? What's their self-esteem like? How are they carrying themselves? Okay? Right? Who are they hanging out with? So the high school, it gives them an opportunity to be from all walks of life. But you know how clicky high school students are? Oh, you hang out down in the music hall. Okay, you're one of those music kids. Okay, yeah, they're weird. And I always make fun of the math kids, you math geeks in my class. Not fun of them in an intentional way, but fun with them so that they help them understand some of this, but who's popular and who's not popular. And you see how young people want to fit in. Who do they want to be? Okay, and you help them understand that person right there probably has issues too. If that's their thing. There's stuff going on there too. They might not get along well with other people. Okay, they might be annoying or provoking, or they antagonize others for attention. All right, and I have students that do that with me. Okay, they're irritating, they're annoying, and you know you've got to find a way to not diminish them, and you've got to find a way to work with them, and then I also try to help them and change. You know, you've got this habit, and I've noticed this habit, and we'll talk a little bit about that. And then as they get to know you and they get a relationship with them, you can flat out tell them that people see that it's kind of irritating when you do that. And this is how I'm seeing it. To be able to have that dialogue with children and talk with them and listen to what they're saying, you open yourself up, right? Okay, because they're going to want to tell you what they don't like about you. Okay, so are you going to be genuine and transparent enough to allow them to do that within, obviously within the roles of the fourth commandment and within what those things bring? The bullies tend to be aggressive, easily frustrated, and I think the stress is, I really think the stress is there. The more I think about it, what's stressing them out? And is that stress so high, is that level of stress so high for them that the aggression's right there? The frustration, these should be switched around. They get frustrated first and then they become aggressive. They may have less parental involvement or have issues at home. Doesn't necessarily have to be that way. Okay. Okay. Questions, comments on any of this so far? Mike?
Just kind of drawing on some things from my teaching career, and I just remember, obviously I won't use names, but there's this one year that we had, we had somebody who would, not physically, but verbally harass, and just had a really, could put down kids like that, and there was one in particular, this boy named Zach, and they would tease, he was short, so he was different, and they would call him Zacchaeus and things like that, and what they were, it became evident to me what they were looking for is they were looking for a reaction out of him, and they kept getting what they wanted out of him because he was getting frustrated, he was getting mad, and they were pushing his buttons such a way that he was having meltdowns, and it was all because of them. And it's sick, but they were kind of feeding off that, and so once I recognized that, that's what they were doing and stuff that I, would see, obviously, it was handled, with the bully. And I would take, Zach aside and just kind of say, you're giving them right exactly what, they want, And so once he started kind of laughing more things off, they kind of backed off a little bit. And they kind of saw, I guess he's not as bad as I thought he was. And they weren't getting the reaction that they were looking for anymore. And so things diminished. Now things can, sometimes they don't get better like that though.
Right.
And so it gets to be a point where it's out of hand.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Made me think of that.
And that's where it's gonna take a team of individuals. It's gonna take a team of grown ups to get it to stop or get it to end. Parents that are aware of what's going on and happening, parents that want to help. Not just the one side, but want to help both sides. If my son was bullying somebody else, I'd want to know, and I'd want to address it with my son and make sure that behavior was going to stop, and that he was going to show the level of respect to his peers that I was showing him as a parent, or that his classmates were showing him. Find out if there was something going on that's happened to lead into that.
I was reading over that list and I was thinking sometimes I usually deal with younger children. My own are older, but other people's children that I deal with are younger. And sometimes I feel like they have such a need for attention. They don't care if that attention is positive or negative. They just want it.
Mm-hmm.
And I, for some reason that was striking me with this too, that maybe the less parental involvement sort of struck it, but thinking badly of others, difficulty following rules. seems attention getting to me.
Yeah, well, and that's what, that was the situation that you described, Mike, too. The kids are pushing the other students' buttons and they're going to sit back and watch. You know, that's entertainment at school. And so it's warped and it's corrupted in the way that it's going on and happening, and school personnel have to be aware of it and then deal with it and educate the students on it. But by the same token, I think, you know, front end is to get it to go away and not happen at all.
And I think that, you know, we've seen that, well, just ignore him, he'll go away. You know, if it's not handled in the right way, years of bullying or picking on after so much time does become bullying. And if the adults don't stop in and make a conscious effort not to say, Amanda, just ignore him. He'll go away in time or whatever. It just, I think that becomes a problem.
School districts have been sued and lost lawsuits because of that, what you just said, ignoring it. I'm just going to tell you, I've got an activity for you here in a little bit. How much time do I have, you know?
10.
Okay. Maybe I'll give it to you as a handout and just show you. So, who's at risk of both? Who's going to be doing this? Look at the polar opposites here. Okay. And when I read those two statements and found those two statements, I said, well, it can be anybody. It can be anybody on any given day, okay?
So when I read those statements,
mm-hmm.
The first one seems like they would possibly choose to bully in order to keep their status, and the other ones would do it to try to gain the status of the other.
Good perception.
And I think that the top sector would almost, is that like the cyberbullying? I know that's not necessarily like, but I think you see that a lot, like to make yourself more popular, to make fun of other people, that happens more where the bottom stuff may be like more physical or aggression.
Yeah. I'm gonna, for the sake of time, okay, so how do you know kids are being bullied? Do you have any questions about, you know, what you're looking for as far as signs or anything, or you pretty much got that? You know, there's all kinds of things depending on what kind of bullying it is that's going on and happening. Their sleep patterns disrupted, their eating habits are out of whack. You know, it's because it's eating away at them on the inside. And so they're struggling with it, and as they're struggling with it, their systems in their body are trying, they're stressed out and they're trying to deal with it internally. And if they haven't shared it with somebody and it hasn't been resolved and it's going on and ongoing, you need to be aware of some of the things that are going on and happening. So, on the opposite side, how do you know if they're bullying or not? Okay, they're usually getting into trouble. You're hearing about it. A lot of times they won't take responsibility. The blame game happens, and it'll be somebody else's fault. They're competitive, you know, combative more so than competitive. They may get defensive very easily with any adults, including the parents. If it gets brought up, what's going on happening in school, I'm hearing about this. And so they, so one of the things, though, that we have to struggle with at the high school, and I think an awareness helps here too, is that is it bullying or is it something else that's going on and happening? And so I gave you a definition for bullying. It's repetitive behavior. It's repetition of inappropriate behavior, and then there's power. And then that third one down, it's done with intent. Okay, it's done with intent. It's premeditated. And then whereas we might have a conflict going on and happening in school. So he broke up with me, and now he started dating her, and those two girls got into it. And then there's a fight at the end of the school day. That's a conflict. That's not bullying. Okay. And we've had that go on and happen. So I'm just, you know. So and it's, you know, usually if you're in a school system like we are, or the high school students.
Elementary.
No, it's so going now. What they're doing is they're getting it going. They're getting it going outside of school. Okay, and that's where the social media works against us in the school, because they're getting it all wound up outside of school, and then school's a place where everybody's going to meet in person, and then all of a sudden we're dealing with an event that has absolutely nothing to do with school, but now it's here, so now we have to deal with it, and so you know, just so you're aware, just if there's a situation going on and happening in school, take a step back and get, you know, just start to think about a process that you want to follow to get the information and get the facts first before you jump to a conclusion that it's more severe than what it may be. Okay, I'm not diminishing the fact that bullying doesn't go on and happen, but sometimes it's not. We've already had parents overreact and say, why are you not doing anything about this? She's being bullied, she's being harassed. We have literally gone on a fact-finding mission, talking to teachers, talking to other students, observing in person. We have one report from a parent. She's coming home. She's telling us she's getting bullied. Where is this happening? When is this happening? We've had the student in describing it to us, and then we've gone out and we have observed none of it, okay, over time. And it continues to get reported. And so it's like there's something else going on here and happening. And getting parents to realize what are the facts, you know. And generally, if bullying is going on and happening, the children don't want to report it. They don't tell anybody. Sad, but okay. And I don't know how accurate the statistics are when you get surveys involved, because I teach psychology, that aspect of psychology, and how, you know, survey results can get skewed one way or another, but. In general, this report's saying that 40%, less than 40% of bullying incidents are getting, adults are getting notified, parents or school officials, and the reasons why.
Can I interrupt?
Yep.
I don't want to make this longer, and real quick, we're trying to teach them to handle things on their own, and yet we tell them, come tell me when, I mean, I can see the fine line there.
I'm not saying that at all.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I'm not saying handle it on your own at all. And if I gave you that, impression,
you're probably not.
I'm
but
sorry.
As
okay.
teachers, we often tell them you need to learn this on
yeah.
your own. So
right.
yeah, but so that's where I'm. Where do we
yeah.
draw the line?
As a counselor at our high school, I don't do that.
Okay.
I am. I just start documenting. Where is this happening? What's going on? Who's involved? Mm. Who else has been there? Who has seen it? And then I'm trying to get all my ducks in a row before I go forward. And then I want to know all the parties that are involved and what's going on and what's happening. And then work with the students on how we're going to get this to stop.
You're right, we want them to handle it on their own, but a lot of times they don't have the skills.
Right.
So our job as parents and as educators, or those of us that are, is to give those skills.
Yeah, and that's where the empowerment is happening. And that's what I'm getting into right now. So encourage your students to report bullying to a trusted adult. Okay, you gotta, they gotta have a relationship with somebody. Who do they know, who do they trust that they can go to and that they can tell? It can be a favorite teacher, it can be mom or dad, it could be an aunt or an uncle, you know, everybody's gotta be on board. And then what now, it gets, now we find out what's going on and it's happening. Is it, first of all, is it bullying? Okay, is it bullying or is it something else? Okay, and encourage them to talk without condemning. Because the minute you say, you gotta take care of it on your own, what just happened? Mm-hmm. You just slam the door, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
You just slam the door, and the problem's gonna persist. Okay, so sometimes it's hard for me even as a counselor to shut up and listen. Just shut up and listen, because if I listen long enough, they're going to say what they need to say to help themselves a lot of times. And it, all it takes is, so what would you like to do about this? Well, I know I should. And are you going to be there as a level of support to get them there? Okay? And then the kindness and respect, you know, we're going to model it. You know, you as parents are modeling it at home. You're going to model it. We're your Christian teachers are modeling it here at school. And so they know, if we call them out on it, they know how to act and behave. What are my expectations? What do I expect of you? And, you know, and then we have the power of God's way to do that too. And then I think this is a big... this is a big deal going forward. Empower the children to be learning bystanders. Okay, get everybody involved. So if you have to develop a school policy, I don't know if you have one or not. You do?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Recent?
I don't know. Actually, okay. Being my first year here, I don't know. I know it's in...
That's an excuse.
It is.
I've heard this before. Wait a minute.
Yeah. It's all coming back to you, isn't it?
You know, what is the policy? And have you seen it? And are you aware of it? Is it a good policy? Is it time to review it? And then are the parents engaged? Are the teachers and the parents on board with what that policy is? And then are we going to enact that policy? Are we going to live it? And are we going to support our children in following it? And that's team building.
I have a question. Is this taught to the students in schools on what to do and what bullying is? Don't you think they should be taught this too so they can recognize it?
It's part of the plan.
Is it?
Yeah. One of the resources that I have up here is the state site, and they have a model of a plan. They have an outline what the plan should have, what the plan, and it's your definition of whatever bullying is. The state does not say what bullying is. It says what harassment is. They're close.
Because they should be taught what bullying is, and then they should also be taught on how to handle it if they are being bullied.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. And so here's kind of where I will end up. Respond quickly, consistently to the behavior. Don't ignore it. Okay, don't put it back on the student. Okay, show them that you're invested in them. Don't overreact though either, okay? Because if you overreact, they're gonna freak out and then they're backing out, right? Well, just wait until I call Mr. Henning tomorrow. So, you know, and if your son or daughter hears that, it's like, you know, okay? You might have to go and talk with Mike and go find out what's going on and happening. He might be aware of something. He might be totally in the dark and say, I don't know what's going on. Okay? Find out the facts, and remember we're going to support all the children involved. Okay? Don't throw the bully under the bus, because there's probably stuff going on happening there too. So here's where the plan comes in. Is everybody aware? Is everybody educated? Okay? Are the policies, rules, and procedures doable? Are they manageable? And then how do you go about building that safe environment through education and awareness? The cyberbullying stuff, man, my kids were grown up before it happened. Okay? They were in college. They were in college when this is my daughter's phone she gave back to me. It's my phone. This is the phone she gave back to me after she was done with it. She's on her husband's plan right now. So my students go, Ms. Schmuck, what is that? I said, this is a cell phone. I said, watch. And my wife, who is assistant director of technology, pulls her phone out and flips it. And the kids go, Mrs. Schumacher, aren't you dead? So here's for you as parents, where are they, what are they doing, and whom are they doing it with out there, okay? It must be your plan. You must have bought it, okay? They don't have that kind of money, all right? And so it's your stuff. Okay, you have a right to it, and you have a right to know where they are and what they're doing. You have to get connected. Okay, I am not pretending to be technologically into that. Okay, I do not Facebook. All right, the only time I text is during the Packer game to my oldest son, who's down in Tennessee. Okay. And we have fired the coaches several times during the course of the season. So review their online communications, install appropriate filters. I just read an article out of Christian Counseling Magazine on filters. I saw the article, I didn't read it. I said, now I got one more thing to do. About filters for, you know, this kind of stuff. And which ones are the good ones and which ones are not so good. So, know their devices and how they operate. That's challenging for me. Their passwords, if for no other reason, in case of an emergency. Should you friend or follow your children on social media?
Yes,
absolutely. I'm just asking. Okay? I'm just asking. All right? My sons and daughters have an aunt that social media is with them. They think that's creepy. Okay. So I have a colleague at school. He's got all of his children's cell phones. They're GPS.
Yeah.
Okay. He can find out where they are at any moment in time. Okay. His kids are high school age or older. So. That's kind of cool. So, okay, establish rules that you want. These are my resources that you can share. Okay, so stop bullying. I'm beyond time, aren't I? And then this one is where they set up the bullying policy and stuff. And assessments. They have bullying assessment tools in there, and then they have policies. There are some podcasts here that are very good that Mike shared with me when I started doing this at the Department of Justice. Sexting, all of that stuff. Go ahead.
Is that information going to be on the school notes, do you know, Mr. Henning?
I am, well, let me step away from
it. However, Mike thinks it shares it with you.
I'm videoing it, and I'm going to upload it to YouTube and then send a link out. And then we're also going to have this PowerPoint available as well.
I shared my PowerPoint, so you got it. Somehow, some way. However, Mike.
Oh boy.
However, Mike gives that to you.
He doesn't like that technology, does he?
Yeah, it doesn't. No. Yeah. And then these are two videos, one for younger children, one for older children on bullying. They can be shown in a school setting. You could watch them at home on YouTube first and see what they're like, and what you want to do. Here's what I teach my psychology students. I have Molly in class this year, so we just went through this. This part of the brain is called the anterior cingulate cortex. It fires when you are in pain. So when you have physical pain, this part of your brain registers it. Okay, this is the frontal cortex, this is the front of your head. Okay, in adolescence, into early adulthood, okay, now we know, like, some of the students into their early 20s, the frontal cortex is your executive function. It's your moral compass, it's your rational, logical, reasoning, think before you act moment. This is the last thing that hooks up in a child's brain.
So much.
Last thing that hooks up in a child's brain. Okay? And sometimes between sophomore and junior year, when the young men are going, wait for it. It's senior year, I got a new class now. Okay? And they got it. I see some seniors this year, it's not there yet. Who are these that it's not connected? They're impulsive. They'll throw something out there. They'll say something, and it's not necessarily inappropriate. They'll say something, you just stop and wait. He's like, nope, just wait. He's going to figure this out. So that activates under physical pain, okay? But ostracized individuals have increased activity here. What is ostracism? Social exclusion. What is social exclusion? It is that you said it earlier. It's that bullying without bullying kind of moment, you know? That implicit, it's hidden. What are we doing? We're excluding. So I'm not friending you on social media. no way. Right? And then all of a sudden they're out in the cold. So they're not in, they're in the out group, but they're not in the in group anymore. How do they feel? Right? So we talk about this in school. This is back to my need to affiliate with anyone. Well, what comes out of that? If that continues and that persists and they continue to be on the outside of their peer group and not fitting in and they continue to be excluded, self-defeating behaviors are going to come. They're going to shut down. They're going to lock themselves out. They're going to start to put the walls up. Nobody's getting in. And then they begin to underperform in the school setting, in other places, out on the court, you know, the field, at work. They may develop a lack of empathy. And the lack of empathy is, I care for you and what's happening to you. And so the school violence that goes on and happens in schools a lot of times, I'm talking the stuff that makes the news, the shootings, a lot of times this is a contributing factor to that. Somehow, some way, those people have been excluded from their peer group, and now this is how they're going to get back. I'm done. I got to finish up because I've gone way too long. Just some scripture to share with you. Mike had said maybe something to wrap it up with, something related to scripture. I have to be honest with you, I didn't have anything. It came late last night, and I said, okay, there it is. I've got it. Okay? And Jesus was speaking to his disciples and his followers, and he said, love each other as I have loved you. Okay? And lay down. You know, no greater love is there than I have that compassion, and I have that empathy for you. I will walk with you side by side. I will share your burdens. I will carry your burdens. It's so hard for young people to develop that and get that at an early age because what are we doing? We're sending them towards your focus, right? You got to do this. Now you got to do this. Now you got to be here. Now you got to be here. You got to be here, and then. we don't have time to share the care, the compassion, much less listen to their hurts and what's going on and what's happening to them. And Jesus reminds us, and this is a good reminder for children who are suffering too, your students that are suffering, your children, God chose you out of time and out of eternity, so you are somebody special. And you're going through a difficult time right now, but you know what? Somewhere down the road, you're going to have, through this difficult time, you're going to have an opportunity to help other people who are hurting like you're hurting right now. And you can be a part of the solution and help other people going forward who may not understand what's happening at that point in time. And so he ends them in this command, I share with you, love each other. And you got a blessed opportunity to do that with some wonderful children. Please send them my way. If I live long enough, I will teach them AP psychology. I must be really old, right?
I'm pretty old, so you're older. So.
I have his daughter in my class right now. I feel like a grandfather.
Grandfather.
I am.
Eight times.
Oh. Yeah, it's awesome. It's an awesome experience. Questions? Anything I can share with you? Comments? I've gone way too long.
Are you familiar with the Children's Hospital program that they have? By chance, it's called Act Now.
I've heard of it.
Because it's actually, I mean, it's a program that starts, I mean, I heard someone talk about it. It's a program targeting K-4 through 8th grade, and they do stuff through online, some stuff with online. Obviously, it's going to be secular-based, but it's supposed to help teach the kids young to make better, you know, decisions when it comes to certain situations.
Send it my way. Definitely.
You know, it doing activities with the kids that get them to do that and demonstrate that and to, you know, develop those critical thinking skills early. You know, present for them scenarios and stuff. And I had an activity tonight with a bunch of scenarios. You had to tell me whether it was conflict, whether it was bullying, or whether there wasn't enough information. I can leave those here with you if you want. Enjoy those. I got those off of one of the websites too. So this website here is where I got most of my information that I shared with you tonight. So I just want you to know I didn't reinvent the wheel. This is some of the stuff related to psychology and brain development and stuff that I've seen over time. Only because I'm interested in it. Pastor?
Yeah, I think one other thing too, and this goes to partnering with both the person who is bullying and the person who is receiving that, is a proper understanding of what it means to bear a cross in life. You know, that whatever you're going through at home that's causing a stress is part of enduring a cross. And so how do we deal with that as Christians? And what does God's word have to say about cross-bearing? This isn't the only thing you say, though, because you have to intervene too, right? So that the behavior doesn't continue. But as part of it, you know, we should also be teaching our kids, you know, hey, this life is tough, and this is part of tough life, and the sin that's involved in life, and now you're receiving the sinful actions of another person. So how do we help you build some good resilience towards that so that this can be a positive experience for you? You know, you're not abandoning them. You're not shoving them under the bus. You're partnering with them. We do a lot of cross-bearing talk in pastoral counseling.
Yep.
Because it's
yep.
a huge part of our lives.
Yep. Very valid point.
I know you mentioned that the policies, there's harassment policies and now bullying policies.
Well, there's a harassment statement that's
okay.
A statute. I actually share that with our high school students. That's my freshman and sophomore specifically. We talk about what that is because I tell them the laws that are in the workplace, which some that resonates with some children, some students. The laws that are in the workplace for harassment are also the same laws that apply in a school setting like ours. And so sometimes the kids, it's like they're hearing it for the first time.
So
I don't believe that, but.
Some, like, in most of the harassment laws and policies, it's how you, like, sexual harassment doesn't have to be a specific thing that's said, but it's how the recipient feels about what's being said. You know what I mean? Like, you could make a joke, you know, and, yeah, you don't have to even say, like, oh, that's offensive to me, but you can go and file a complaint. I guess, how is bullying different? It would be how you, if the recipient is receiving that action, and, you know what I mean, like,
It becomes bullying when it's repeated. It becomes bullying when there's a power struggle or a power play going on and happening. A harassment issue could be a one-time thoughtless word, thoughtless act, thoughtless action. It happened to my wife the other day. She was with a group of men, and the inauguration was playing. They had it up on TV, and one of the men made the comment while she was there, like she's one of the guys, because she's one of a few women in technology, made the comment about how attractive the Trump women were. And that was a little bit, for her, that was demeaning and, you know, kind of belittling, and she took a little bit of offense at that. She didn't say anything about it, but, you know, that thoughtless word, that careless, not having, and there you've got adults.
Mm-hmm. So, bullying doesn't go away when you grow up. It just takes different forms.
Right, and that's why the laws are so in the workplace are what they are, because it does continue, and it does go on, and it does happen. And so, with the children, we usually tell them, with our high school students, once I say it is a law, and this could be a consequence, meaning police can be involved. If the family that this has happened to, or you continue to do this, wants to file charges and press charges, they can. And the police are going to be here. So you need to understand this has to, you know, most of the time when I'm having that conversation with them, it's not bullying that's going on. It is isolated incidents of, okay.
I think what you mentioned earlier, too, about investigating and talking to other kids that may have seen, I think that plays an important role as well. We had our son's at Wisco. He was called to the principal's office earlier this year because someone had reported bullying going on at his lunch table, and they wanted his input and what he had seen. And just to talk to kids not directly involved with the bullying, but have them take a look at the table a different way. And it caused our son to switch places with the kid that was being bullied, to say, you know, let's move you farther away from those kids. You know, and I think kids don't always look at a situation, read it as bullying, but the recipient feels that way. You know, just to clue in those around that could help.
I have intentionally gone and engaged the bystanders.
I think they hold a lot of power.
A lot of times they're upperclassmen. I'll say, hey, you know, I don't know, I know you got your locker down in this hallway, but can you kind of watch out for this student? I think he's struggling a little bit. And then if you get an opportunity, can you talk with him and introduce yourself and see if you need some help somehow, some way? It's more powerful than what I can do as a counselor.
Yeah, I'm thinking of like the situation that I brought up before, and you know, I addressed the bully and the bully's parents. I addressed I'll use the term victim, you know, and try to, you know, kind of coach him a little bit as far as next time try this or try that. What my main takeaway from tonight is what I should have done is I should have built that culture with the other ones. The other ones who were not necessarily getting harassed, but they were also not stopping it either, and not wanting to get it themselves. Right? And what I should have done is I should have built more of a culture with them, like this isn't okay, and should have, you know, put more eggs into that, trying to get that, you know, make more of a school culture kind of thing. And when I think about our school culture too, I'm very encouraged by, you know, when we have, like, once in a while our recesses will overlap, and I'll have big ones, and, you know, we'll have big kids and little kids, right? together. We try not to do that too often, right? But sometimes it happens, and I remember the first couple times it did, I was like, oh boy, you know, we got to make sure this is not going to be good, big kids, little kids. I mean, there's a safety issue there too, right? But, you know, when I took a look at what was taking place at recess, it was a very positive, nurturing, you know, thing going on with the upper graders and the lower graders, you know, but at the same time, you know, I think you can always get better, you know, and you can always improve. And, you know, as far as, you know, building that culture, you know, I think we can, you know, talking about the bullying policy, we do have one in place. It's kind of in different places, but I think we can get that more concise, you know. And I mean, if I asked you if you knew our bullying policy, I'm thinking maybe we wouldn't, right? Well, maybe that's a problem, right? I mean, especially in light of this, we should all be on the same page with that, right? So that's something that, you know, we definitely want to do.
I would just encourage you to review it, and then, you know, if it's good, adopt it. You know,
yeah.
It's already adopted, but then put it forward. But then it's the culture. It is exactly what you said, Mike. It's you as parents now live it, breathe it. You encourage it, and you develop it in your children. The teachers are going to do that also along with you, because they are acting in support of you as Christian parents. And that's what you have tasked them to do. And so take on that role and take on that responsibility. Not that you haven't already, but I fear for our kids out there. I have to be honest with you. Our older kids, it was within the last 2 years that suicide became the number two cause of death among college-age students. And that's disturbing. It's just, the number one cause is accidents. And then there's this speculation, how many of those accidents were intentional? You know, that young person wanted to know. Stress, okay? And that stress. So you talked about, Pastor talked about what's going on and happening in the family and then coming to school. But it can be in the school, okay? It can be in the school. A poor performing student who's struggling in school and he's not getting the help that he needs and he's not being successful. He's not seeing the light of day and he's buried. We got to reach out to that at-risk student and give him or her the resources within our power to be able to assist them and help them. We don't keep all of the students that we have at Wisconsin Lutheran High School. We have attrition for any number of reasons. One of the reasons is me being honest with a parent and saying, we do not have the resources to help your son or daughter here. We don't have the support staff, we don't have special education, and so we are not going to be able to meet their needs. And having that candid, open, honest, you know, is very, very helpful. Most of the time my students appreciate that about me. I tell them I'm brutally honest, sometimes painfully so, but most of the students would rather have that than you circling around. And I just tell them if you want Kleenex, go to Mrs. Festerling next door. She's the female on staff. I'm joking about that. I can be, I'm very empathic in the moment, so I also enjoy humor. So thank you for the opportunity to come and talk with you tonight. I would encourage you to use the resources, a lot of things that you're asking about tonight are there. And God's blessings to you. And if I had all the money in the world, I'd give it to you so you could send your children to Wisconsin with me.
Thank you.
Long enough now, I've talked you through.